Just turn the telly on here, shouldn't take long to warm up. I dropped a new spark plug in her the other night. She's going pretty good now. Sit down and watch this program. They reckon it's pretty good. Hang on a minute, I'll check that the aerial's all right. Got to allow for the hills and the reception here. Can't be too careful with these aerials, of course. Got a mate who ran into a bit of bother the other day with aerials. He was playing about with them without the glovey protection. They reckon he got a bolt up his arm. Not too pleasant. Anyway, sit down. I'll make you a cup of beer at half time.
G'day. All right. The story. To be perfectly Francis with you.
The Dag Party has a policy on everything.
Oh, yes, indeed. Oi!
How are you going to enforce those laws?
With the boot.
There you go, Dunedin.
That's the canopy.
Sit down!
Get in behind!
Get out, you rotten!
It'll be the phone.
You can't play around with nature like that, David.
No, I don't live in a cultural desert at all.
How would you rate the quality of life in New Zealand?
Oh, crack!
Turn the separator off!
And it's still Daggy Bully. He's in the last turn. He'd be going for the judge at any moment now, and the only other flea left in the race would appear to be Big Hero. It's Daggy Boy, although he's slowed down almost to a crawl now as Daggy Boy, and here comes the expected challenge from Big Hero. Can Daggy Boy withhold the challenge? Can he withhold the challenge? They're almost up to the line. Can Daggy Boy hold the challenge? I think he can. And as they go to the line, it'll be, hello.
There's been an inquiry into the running of that race. I'm not quite sure why. We'll have a look at the inquiry. We'll take care of the inquiry, and all placings have been confirmed.
Fred Dagg had probably always been in my head somewhere, I think, from early childhood, and it was the sort of character that I'd mucked about with all through school and stuff. It probably emerges, at least in part, from the way people used to have one another on, adults, when I was a kid, to a very amusing effect, I thought, without jokes. It's partly tonal.
Daylight saving. Your opinion of daylight saving?
Oh, yeah. What the hell's daylight saving, mate?
Well, sir, instead of being 8 o'clock in the morning, it'll be 5 o'clock in the morning, so that the sun gets up 3 hours early and it sets 3 hours early.
You can't play around with nature like that, David.
I haven't ever been a great rememberer of jokes and stuff, and I didn't ever want to be a kind of stand-up comedian or anything. So I don't know what it is that I'm doing, really, but I certainly started it at that time. It could be carbon dated to 1973, whatever it is.
Now, the actual form itself, first of all, what you've got to do is there's a table in here, a particularly interesting little table it is too. You go over to the back page, you work out what you're going to need for, you know, basic running expenses, and you fill that amount in under refund. And then you work back through the form until you come to such things as dependent relatives. Now, that, for instance, is catered to getting a refund. In my own personal case, I have a standing arrangement with a family up the road from me that breeds like rabbits. Now, they come in about once a year for a bit of gherkin soup, and we fill me form out. Just a moment, that'll be the phone. Yeah? Inland Revenue. Yeah, which one? Is it the big bloke we had here last year? Yeah, beauty. Ripper. Thanks. Yep. Now, listen, you might like to have a look through the forms. They're particularly interesting, those forms.
I got involved in doing some stage shows when I was at university, and I was about sort of 18 or 19 or 20 or something, and Fred Dagg was one of the elements of the way we were mucking about at the time, so it occurred there. Probably in its full manifestation in 1971, on stage at Victoria University in a show called One and Five.
Yeah, g'day. There's Trev there, please. G'day, Mrs. Burke. Yeah, it's Bruce here. Bruce. Trev's friend, Bruce.
Very late in 1973, a current affairs program had a kind of end-of-year wrap-up, and a few of us were invited to participate in that, and that was his first television appearance. Duck shooting in Willis Street, as I recall.
Excuse me, sir. Excuse me.
Oh, yeah.
The public response was immediate and very gratifying, and a good thing too, because there were some jitters at what might be called the management level in New Zealand broadcasting at the time.
Well, women are just not suited to middle and top level administration. They're far too emotional. They can't think rationally. They get too emotionally involved with what they're doing. Now, men are not like that. We look at things from a detached point of view and can make better decisions.
In 1973 and 4, there was no videotape. This is one of the reasons that nobody's got copies of a lot of Fred Dagg stuff, was that you couldn't record it. It was shot on film, with a film camera and a separate sound system, and edited on a Steenbeck in a way that things aren't edited very much any longer. It was a slightly longer process, but it was one I learnt to understand, and I remember on one occasion going out there to shoot something, and there were no operators available, so I logged a camera out, and I went and stood it in the car park at Avalon, pointed it at a tree, focused it on the tree, started the Nagra and went and stood next to the tree and did a monologue to camera, turned the camera off and went to processing. So you actually learnt to do quite a lot of things by having to. It was, you know, at one level pretty rudimentary, but it was an awfully good way to learn a lot of very good tricks.
Mr. Dagg, you may not want to answer this question, but yeah. I'd like you to tell me truthfully how many sheep you in fact have.
Around 2 million. Around about 2 million. My wife put them through the race the other day while I was knocking off my porridge in the morning, and she reckoned they were about 2 million.
Have you ever had time to count them? Have you done that?
I've had time, yeah, but I've never done it.
Why not?
Too busy, mate.
And the suggestion was that some people were pretending to retain some stock they didn't actually have in order to obtain the benefit deriving therefrom. I found that very difficult to believe, and I tried to point that out.
We here retent the sheep in March, and then we retent them again in October, and if any have slipped through, then we whip out after dinner and retent them in the yard.
Mr. Dagg, I imagine this whole process must involve the payment to you of fairly substantial sums of money.
Yeah, I should imagine so, yeah.
Well, Mr. Dagg, I wonder if we could see some of these alleged sheep.
I wonder if we could. Now, you see that hill over there?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, down in that first saddle, see that white thing? I think that's one of them. Just a minute, that's a rock. They don't have a rock retention scheme, do they, the gammon?
Would you mind if I made a head count?
Not at all. No, that's all right. You just jack your slide rule up. I'll go and get you some. Hang on.
So this wasn't so much the free market at work, this was the free market just not getting out of its pyjamas properly and going back to bed. It preceded the the rigorous free market in which we now operate.
I'll be along in a minute.
The international issue that most impacted on New Zealand, other than economic change in the 70s, was the beginning of a New Zealand sensibility being developed over nuclear issues, because the French were conducting bomb tests at Mururoa, and we didn't know that we liked that. We didn't expect people to come and have a big poop in our backyard.
I have reason to believe, that is to say I've got no reason not to believe, that I've invented a bomb of catastrophic proportions.
Could you describe your bomb? What does it look like?
Well, it looks like a bomb. I mean, a bomb's a bomb. Up the sharp end, you've got the lead, and that bit's going to hurt. Then there's, in the middle canister, there's all these chemicals and things of a highly technical nature, which I can't actually pretend to understand terribly well myself. And in the final, the last canister, there's just a whole lot of other stuff that I found around on the concrete of the milking shed after milking. And what? I think that last section, if everything else fails, might be a little cracker.
Where is the test area? Have you have you found one yet?
Well, yeah, the wife and I struggled over the Atlas last night trying to find a test area. We don't want it to be too near to New Zealand so that the ghastly fallout and firestorms and such like don't affect the good people in New Zealand. So we've got an area a long way away from New Zealand where we won't be affected at all. Not to put too fine a point on it, France.
It has to be remembered that when all of this was happening, there was one TV station, it was black and white, and everything on it was either live or film. And there weren't very many New Zealanders on it. The news was read by an adult in a dinner suit, and the weather was world-quality weather.
G'day. 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 Now, the weather. The weather today over this this area here, this big, the green bit here, it wasn't bad by all accounts. In this other bit here, it wasn't bad by all accounts either. Not a bad sort of a day all round, really. Now, the one thing about today was that there was absolutely no rain anywhere. I don't know where that came from. What there was, though, there's a fair bit of minor weather, you might call it, flashing about the place. I know for a fact it was raining in Tai Abbey the other night when I come through. There's all sorts of Japanese invasion on the west coast. Be very careful of that one. There's a bit of that in Wellington. I don't know what it is, but be very, very careful of it. There's a mate of mine in Gisborne looking for rain. Here you are, Trev. Just for you, mate. Rain. Now, in Dunedin, and you Dunedin people probably can't see that. You probably haven't seen the weather for a couple of weeks. I'll see what I can do about it for you. Cloudy in Dunedin tomorrow. There you go, Dunedin.
In 1974, the people who ran Country Calendar, which was an enormously popular program on New Zealand television, came to John Bannis and myself, who'd been associated with one another for a very long time over lots of projects and had recently done a program called Buck House. And they asked us to kind of take over the final Country Calendar program of the year.
I see no reason why either of us need run into the other ever again.
All right, that suits me down to the ground.
Good.
There is one thing that rather bothers me, though.
And what is that?
That's my milk.
And it was one of the happiest experiences and certainly one of the better kind of expressions of the Fred Dagg ethos, because you got to tell the whole story.
We've got 14,000 acres, 13,000 in grass and 1,000 in rock up the back. Now what you see here is that the land basically is divisible into two basic types. There's the hill, the actual hill country, and then there's the flat country, which is not got any hills on it at all.
For you. Yeah, g'day. This is the milking setup. She's been, as far as farm economics is concerned, she's been a fair proposition. We were going to put in a rotary setup, but But the brother-in-law's got one of those, and they're not perhaps as good as they're cracked up to be. He's had a bit of trouble with it. Apparently, something went wrong with the rotary mechanism, and he found he was homogenising his milk before it left the property, which apparently doesn't pay.
Get out of there!
It broke, and we've had people out from the town looking at it. All joggers, all sorts of joggers, but they didn't seem to be able to work out what was the matter with it. Actually, the wife fixed it one night. Never found out what was the matter with it. Hello? That's the neighbour. He's looking for a couple of hundred tutus he lost a couple of weeks ago. He won't find them out there. We buried them up the back there. He'll never find them.
What we are about to receive, we must remember to thank the old shoeman.
I run the place with my sons, of whom there are approximately half a dozen. Trevor here, he's the firstborn, and he's the eldest as a result of that. And
all the Trevor Daggs were, in fact, christened. They're all completely legitimate. I have the certificates. I've subsequently bumped into quite a lot of people who were a Trev at one time or another. I just thought that was a funny idea.
The reason I don't like going into town is, the first reason is that, the whole thing is rather confusing. In the simple respect, for instance, of driving. Now, I mean, a bloke has been driving since he was four. A bloke can drive up and down, backwards, he can drive in his sleep. But go to town, and last time I was in town, for instance, what used to be a two-way street's now a one-way street. You can't turn here. You used to be able to turn there, and now that's a block of flats and stuff. It's very, very difficult. Another thing is, a bloke gets dressed up. A bloke's perfectly normal in all respects. He's wearing very, very conventional clothing. He gets out in the streets, and everybody stops and looks at him. Which is by no means comforting to the rural person, in which category I class myself. As a result, it's a wee bit on the horrendous side as this town going. It has to be done. It has to be done. I make no bones about it, but I do like to try, in so far as is possible, to play it my own way. Machinery and equipment are precision articles, and they've got to be very, very well maintained indeed. They've got to be looked after, they've got to be cared for, or otherwise they're just not going to pay. They're going to be uneconomic, there's nothing worse on a farm than an uneconomic, non-paying proposition. At the moment, I've got a totally non-paying, uneconomic proposition to the tune of 14,000 acres. As I was telling you, we're having a bit of trouble with the milking gear. So I've invented a machine to get round it. Most of it's down at the patent office. We've been waiting for it to come back for a couple of days, but the railways won't touch it. We'll be back shortly, but we have one or two bits and pieces here which we can explain to you. Firstly, the idea being that we milk the cows out on the field. G'day. Yeah. We milk the cows out on the paddock, and then we go around with this machine and we collect the milk. The problem being that we've got to separate the milk from the hay, and this has been a rather tricky one, but let me just explain to you. Basically, this piece of mechanism here, that's the canopy. Get that out of the way for you. Now what happens basically is that this thing here, the hay, and lies it on the ground. Get rid of that for you. And the next thing that happens is that this machine here, which is connected with a piece of chain, like so, now this picks the hay up with the milk. Just get rid of that for you. Get that out of the way there. Now the milk is then pumped up through this, or pumped down, depending on whether the machine's upside down, which happened the other day, rather a tricky one that. But that's the pump that, that's what that does. Now then, g'day. That's the neighbour. He's looking for his tractor. I don't think he'll find it, actually. Most of it's incorporated in the bit that's down at the patent office. The wool clip that we get off this particular place is now not getting half the money we were getting, and as a result, sheep, well, quite frankly, they don't pay.
Now, as a result, instead of shearing twice a year, what we're doing at the moment is we're not shearing this year, and we're putting back onto the sheep the wool we took off them in the previous year. Now, this process, the wooling, goes on at approximately the same time as the shearing used to.
That was quick. It was good, but it was quick. Hang on a minute. That can't be. Oh, no, it's a commercial break. It's a commercial break. Won't be long. You want a drink? Beer? Milk?
Well, that's about all there is to it, really. It's a pity I can't get it going for you. But, sit down!
Well, after the country calendar program, Fred Dagg was relatively fully formed as a concept, and as a sort of, it had a geography now, and it had a broader sort of a family context and a business context, but there wasn't much I could do with it because there weren't program opportunities.
Yeah, g'day. Well, now we've got two channels. The only remaining question is how you pick them up. Now, you're going to need an aerial, and it's not really very difficult to do. The stupidest person in the world could do it, and I'll now attempt to prove that thesis. First of all, it's raining and it might be a bit cold, so don't forget the old heater.
So I formed this relationship with the current affairs program and I began to do regular and semi-regular bits and pieces which drew their subject matter from what was actually happening in current affairs.
Now, if you live south of Tai Abbey, and let's face it, most of us do, you've got to turn the whole thing upside down and get all these elements working in another way. Now, what you've got to do is to make an allowance for the hill. You've got to bend the elements around so that they can pick up the signal around the hill. And then you've got to just get hold of this piece of cord and jab it into the heater just to connect the power up. And with any luck, you should be in business.
Fred Dagg, you've come out in favour of censorship.
Yep.
Can you tell me why?
Yeah, I can. I went to see a film the other day called The Night Porter, which I thought was going to be a film, a documentary picture about Sir Humphrey Porter, the well-known person. He was knighted the other day for his services to fencing wire, and it happened not to be a film about him at all. Wire was hardly mentioned, and when it was mentioned, it had very little to do with Sir Humphrey.
Whichever reporter on the programme wasn't terribly busy got stuck with having to come out and interview me, and they were all very good about it. And a lot of them have stayed in television, people like Ian Fraser and Lindsay Perrigo and Gillian Woodward and Spencer Jolly and Bill Earle and Murray McLaughlin and all sorts of people.
Have you had any other experiences?
Oh, yes, I have. Considerable number of experiences. I remember just after the war, a couple of mates and me ran a market of bring and buy and tie heavy.
Well, then what do you recommend?
Well, I recommend that everybody in New Zealand gets together and watches all the films that are available, uncut, and then afterwards we have a bit of a chat about it and work out whether or not we should have watched them.
But aren't you afraid that people may be as drastically affected as you've obviously been?
Yeah, with any luck, it should be a good meeting.
Terry Carter was another one, and they got quite good at asking extremely straight questions because the things really only worked if they took me seriously.
Mr. Dagg, what do you think of the Prime Minister's argument that New Zealanders are just not the sort of people who would accept bribes?
Well, I think it's a very sound argument. To be perfectly frank with you, I'd go along more or less, probably about 78% with that argument, and for $10 and 100 weight of pig food, I'd probably go along with it in total.
Mr. Dagg, this oil you say you've discovered here, do you think it's in commercial quantities?
Oh, yes, I should think so, yeah. There's a lot of it down there.
How can you tell?
Well, if you bang your foot on the ground, you can hear it all swilling around in there. It's a big field, a very big field indeed.
How many barrels?
Well, I don't know about barrels, but I should say there'd be at least a couple of gallons down there.
2 gallons?
2 or 3 gallons, or maybe three.
Is that all the oil here, or would there be other...
There are other fields. There's 15 or 20 fields up behind the woolshed.
How do you know that?
to tell you the truth, I put it there myself just after the war when the price was low, and now the price has gone up, I think it's time we had a few discoveries around the district.
Your oil, when it goes onto the market, is it going to bring the price down?
I would sincerely hope not. No, that would be the reverse of the trend that I'm hoping for. I would say that if I play my cards right, the price might even go up.
How much would you expect to get out of your field?
Oh, around about, approximately, give or take, I believe it, somewhere around the zillion mark would be a most suitable amount to make out of this. Of course, not very good oil at the present point in time.
I see you're smoking. Surely that's dangerous.
Well, it would be under normal circumstances, but this oil is very poor quality in its crude stage. This is called New Zealand Sour, and it's a very thin oil. We have to mix a bit of corn flour with it. The old Sheila's doing that present point in time in the separator, as a matter of fact. And we mix corn flour with it to give it the right consistency for the motorised uses.
Mr. Dagg, what's your position on this current controversy?
Well, my position at the present point in time is that I have reason to believe I never gave an interview.
But surely you must know whether you gave an interview or not.
Not altogether. Yes, I have reason to believe. At the time that I was giving the interview, I wasn't there. Shall we say that? I was absent at the time. I wasn't there at all at the time that I was allegedly giving the interview.
Where were you?
I was involved in deep and very, very meaningful talks with the Minister for the Environment at that time.
Can that be confirmed?
I believe that can be confirmed. I can confirm that to you and get back to you. Certainly, yes.
Who is the Minister for the Environment?
I am. Just a minute, that'll be the phone. I'm not here. I'll ask me to ring you back later. Thank you. Sorry about the interruption there.
Well, I take it then that the reporter who claims to have spoken to you is mistaken?
I believe so, yes. Trevor Mistaken. He works for the Otago newspaper, and I believe he's wrong, yes.
Well, how could he make such a mistake?
I have no idea. He might have been talking, of course, to somebody who looks very like me, sounds like me, is about my height, about my stance, and he may have spoken to such a person, somebody who is so more or less identical to me in such a way that the average person would not be able to tell the difference.
You think there are many people like that?
There appear to be thousands of them about, yes. We're having a lot of trouble with them at the present point in time.
Mr. Dagg, thank you for this interview.
What interview is that? You've been interviewing somebody.
If I were to state on oath that I wrote these pieces in the sense that I wrote them down before doing them, I wouldn't go too well under cross-examination. Because one of the lessons I was needing to learn at this time was the usefulness and the value of writing. I used to make them up.
Now, another very important aspect of our work is phone tapping, because all sorts of communistic nonsense gets spoken over telephones. So we tap the phones like this with a special tapper that we're provided with by the Brigadier, and no communistic conversation can sneak through here anymore.
Can in a way get away with being a bit loose with your writing on television if you're stupid enough, and I was prepared to be pretty silly to make it work, but in the long run I was going to have to, you know, sit a couple of proper exams.
The other device that we've got for monitoring phone calls is the bugging device. Now, here's a bug here, just happens to be passing, we'll use it. Now, what you do is you whip this bit off the phone here, you put that bug in there and you speak to it very nicely. You say, "Bug, you just stay there and listen very carefully. I'll be back at about 4:15 and I'll ask you to tell me everything that's gone through this phone. Thank you very much indeed." You say to the bug, you whip that back on there, and every communistic comment that goes through this phone is monitored by the bug. Give it a couple more taps, tap it just a little bit more, and that phone now is comprehensively protected against communistic conversation.
In those early years, I could be on television a bit, but it was very, very difficult to make a living because you didn't get paid a lot to make an individual appearance that was quite short. So I had to develop other ways of earning a living, and one of those was to do a couple of commercials.
G'day. I'd like to book a seat on the Big Steel Bird, please. Dagg's the name.
We made it work for everybody, and the way it worked for me was that I made sure that Fred Dagg said a couple of funny things in each commercial so that they worked for the character, and to an extent those commercials became my programs.
You can't stay behind all your life. You got your togs? Most of me luggage cleared up. Something in the way we... Hey, Garcon. Can I please have another couple of half dozens, or make it a dozen, and a plate full of gum leaves from your cobber? Will that do you?
Fantastic.
Beauty. And can you open the window?
Feeling fantastic. It's a feeling nice to know. Feeling fantastic. Feeling fantastic.
My dear praises.
In 1975, there was an election, and the news developed, as it were, a theme, which was the election. And I thought, that's a very good idea, I'll jump aboard that. So I actually stood for public office in the imaginary parallel world in which Fred Dagg lived.
Mr. Dagg.
G'day.
I hear you've decided to contest this year's elections.
That's true.
What's brought you to this decision?
Well, I think that the present incumbents have lost all track with the land,
And I think that the land needs to be better represented in the House. And I don't mean by this that vast amounts of money will be paid to farmers. I don't mean that at all. There's no self-interest in this whatsoever. Monies can be paid to farmers' wives, farmers' sons, farmers' cooperatives, farmers' companies, and all other affiliated agrarian bodies.
Any slogans?
The one we've got at the moment is, it's time for a beer, which we're particularly pleased with, because indeed it is. Keep New Zealand daggish, another one that was suggested.
Have you started campaigning yet?
Oh, yes, indeed. Oh, yes. As a matter of fact, we had a meeting last Saturday. A very well-attended meeting last Saturday. There was some busing involved, but I think we can dispense with any further reference to that. We had 48,000 people.
48,000?
Yeah, last Saturday, 48,000 people at a political meeting in New Zealand. Virtually unheard of.
Where was this?
At Athletic Park. There was actually a football match played at the meeting, just to keep everybody amused. As a matter of fact, some of my more complex policies I don't think were fully understood by the voters.
Mr. Dagg, where did you get the idea for the Citizens for Dagg campaign?
Oh, it's not my idea at all. This is an idea that some of my supporters have had in the more northern regions, and I don't know where they got it from. I believe it they just plucked it out of the air sometime late yesterday afternoon.
Well, it's a steal-in from the Citizens for Rolling campaign.
I've never heard of that, no.
I understand you've got 8 people supporting you, all of them called Dagg.
I believe that's correct, yes. There's T-Dag, 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 T-Dag. There's Trevor Dagg, there's Trev Dagg, and of course there's young Trev, my youngest son, and there's OS Dagg, of course, as well.
Who's OS Dagg?
Oh, that'd be the old Sheila. Yeah, she'd be in there.
All your family, then?
I believe so, yes, yes, indeed.
It's hardly a cross-section of the public, is it?
Well, I don't know. I think there's a fair cross-section, and they're very reputable, some of those people. There's cropping men, there's sheep men, cattle men, there's fencing men, and, of course, there's the old Sheila, who's a force to be reckoned with.
Could you tell me the substance of your proposed legislation?
Yeah, I could. Very briefly, it's a bill which proposes to make it an offence to give people under about 18 years of age the impression that being a Member of Parliament is quite normal and natural.
What is in fact not normal or natural about being a Member of Parliament?
Well, are you one? Am I one? Ask yourself. Hardly anybody is a Member of Parliament. It's a minority thing. They get themselves into positions of power. They're practically running the place some of the time. Oh, indeed, yes. The Dagg Party has a policy on everything. The Dagg Party does indeed have a very strong policy on divorce. We regard marriage as being a joint venture. We're pretty broad-minded in this respect. We regard people as being able to get a divorce. We have imposed a trial separation period of 25 years on the couple, but after that, if either of the parties wants a divorce, then they can have one, of course. Unless, of course, one of the parties involved is a woman.
What about research? Is the Dagg Party looking into research into crime?
It's well known, undeniable, in fact, that most of the crime, probably about 98% of the crime in New Zealand at the present point in time, is committed by criminals, actually, or people attempting to attain criminal status. And sundry ratbags would make up the other 2%. And these are the people we'll be clobbering. We're interested in the little man. We're a party for the little man, and we'll be hitting the little man as hard as we can possibly hit him once we find him.
If I'm 55, married or single, what could I expect under your plan in 5 years' time?
Oh, you can expect to be 60. We're not going to dabble with age at all. We're not going to play around with nature. That'd be stupid. You could expect to be 60, as under the present system.
Could you tell me what happens if I die?
Oh, well, that'd be a shame. Wouldn't it? Yeah, that'd be a pity. I think we'd all say that.
Can you tell me what money...
Oh, money-wise, yeah, sorry. Yeah, you'd get $1 zillion. When you die, you get $1 zillion.
That would go to my wife and dependents.
No, it'd go to you. No, we're looking after you. When your wife dies, she picks up $1 zillion too.
But she gets no money when I die.
Well, I don't know, she got a job, she could probably take care of herself.
Don't you think that your policies could be described as racist?
Not really. You obviously didn't see the address I gave in Auckland last Friday, where I covered myself in nugget and recommended that we get all the white people out of New Zealand by Friday. No, I don't think I'd be classed as a racist by any manner of means. A genius, yes. A racist, no.
Well, there seems to be some conflict here. Who is it that you want to get rid of?
Well, depending on who I'm talking to, I want to get rid of the other lot. So get out there on Saturday and vote. Now, remember not to vote in formal. Don't wear your corduroy pants and your hush puppies. Get fairly well dressed up or your vote won't count. And with any luck, we should be in power on Monday. Give us a ring on Monday. We'll see what we can do for you.
There'd been a national government since time immemorial until 1972.
And in 1972, Norman Kirk became the first Labour Prime Minister since Walter Nash in the late 50s. And he sadly died in office. Bill Rowling became the Prime Minister until the election in 1975, at which Robert Muldoon was elected in a big victory, defeating the Labour Party and sadly myself.
Mr. Dagg,
yeah.
Mr. Dagg, are you depressed at the outcome of Saturday's result?
Not at all, no, I'm delighted.
But you polled only one vote.
Oh, we polled one vote. That represents a 100% swing to the Dagg Party, as the pundits were saying on Saturday night. They're quite right there. A 100% swing to the Dagg Party. Unprecedented, absolutely unprecedented in world history, I should think, that there should be a 100% swing to a party.
Now, did you vote on Saturday?
I did indeed vote on Saturday, yeah.
Whom for?
I voted for a certain agrarian candidate, not a million miles from here.
Yourself?
Oh, I believe that was his name, yes.
Now, what happened to your claim of the large Dagg disciple following? Why didn't they vote for you on Saturday?
Well, there was a big party at the Plough and Chequebook, and I think that debilitated certain of our followers.
Well, when are you going to declare your hand and fold?
I think that I have got a complaint in, of course, to the government printer who printed quite a lot of the voting forms, didn't have the Dagg Party candidate on them at all. And numerous followers of mine have said, where were the names? And I'm actually lost for an answer, absolutely lost.
As Provisional Prime Minister, Mr. Dagg, assuming that is that special votes will give you a majority, what are your priorities?
Priorities? Basically what we're going to do is demolish the existing superannuation legislation, look very closely at broadcasting, and get rid of all the people in important places up and down the country who backed the wrong side in the election.
How long do you think it'll take you to demolish superannuation?
If the weather's good, around about a quarter of an hour.
That mean we can expect our contributions back pretty immediately?
Yes and no. Yes, you can expect them back, and no, probably not this century. It's a very, very tricky business doing that, and I doubt very much whether we'll be able to slip them back to you, actually into your pocket, this century.
Well, taking another of your priorities, what's going to happen with broadcasting?
We'll be replacing broadcasting.
What with?
With Bert Walker.
Why, Mr. Dagg, have you suddenly taken upon yourself to be spokesman for broadcasting?
Because people keep coming and asking me questions about broadcasting. Sit down!
Gumboots, they are wonderful. Gumboots, they are swell. Because they keep out the water and they keep in the smell. And when you're sitting round at home, you can always tell when one of the troops has taken off his gumboots. If it weren't for your gumboots, so where would you be?
The songs came about partly because songs are fun. And I came from a generation who used to sing all the time. That's what we used to do. Parties, you'd sing.
Now Rob Muldoon and Rowling, they haven't made a hit. They're ruining the country more than just a bit. And if they keep on the way they're going, we'll all be in turn. So you better get your feet up your gumboots. If it weren't for your gumboots, so where would you be? You'd be in the hospital or in the infirmary.
When I did the first Fred Dagg record, which was done for EMI, and EMI very generously gave me a morning in which to record an entire album. Such was their confidence in the product. And I thought, well, I can't just make it a monologue, so I needed to do a couple of things. So in the studio, I made up a thing where I was pretending to do the milking and I was singing snatches of song.
Get that fowl out of here, Trevor. Get that chook out of here! Trevor! Get that chook out of there!
Moon River, wider than about a mile. I'm crossing you in an old fish.
One song was supremely silly, and the other was, you know, intending to be a satire, but became an anthem by mistake.
We don't know how fortunate we are to have that place. We don't know how propitious are the circumstances, Frederick. We don't know how lucky we are, mate. We don't know how lucky we are.
And so you get, with any luck, both the kind of enthusiasm about the place
coupled with these rather peculiar critiques of a smugness which might be said to emerge from isolationism.
We just don't realise how fortunate we are. We have no idea of the luck we possess. Collectively, we just don't...
I'd always thought it interesting that New Zealand took great and legitimate pride in its sporting heroes, but it perhaps didn't sufficiently acknowledge people who'd been heroes in other than particularly sporting contexts. So I decided to do an all-black side made up of people who'd sort of done New Zealand proud in the arts and in other general areas. But in my head at the time was that very particular sound that I used to hear when I was a kid of the All Blacks, the team being announced after the trials, under the stand, in sepulchral tones, in an echoey kind of venue, as if it was the most important thing in the history of the universe.
Fullback, E.P. Hillary, Auckland. Wing three quarters, R.J. Hall, Otago. D.F. Dobbin, Auckland. Centre, K. Takanawa, Auckland.
And I like the fact that the All Black side contained women too. I think that's something that should happen, actually.
Second 5-8, N. S. Neal, Otago. First 5-8, A. J. Kerno, Auckland. Halfback, R. Hotere, Otago. Number 8, P. Jackson, Auckland. Flankers, L. Tamahori, Auckland. J. Campion, Wellington. Locks, B. T. Finn, King Country. N. M. Finn, King Country. Props, K. Hume, West Coast. M. Mahey, Canterbury. Hooker, J. P. Frame, Potawatomi.
In the late 70s, Fred went on a very important trade mission to Australia, and this is valuable work, and it goes on to this day.
Magnificent, well-proportioned, large, convenient block with exquisite low-maintenance garden means there's no view, but one of the trees had a flower on it the day we were up there.
Australian farnarkling received a much-needed shot in the arm with the news that Australia have eliminated Sweden in a nip-and-tuck affair in sub-zero temperatures at the all-weather farnarkling centre in Gothenburg earlier today, Australian time.
Was that you? Huh? Must have been me. Sorry.
Hey, Mr. Wilson, have you measured the 100 metres track?
Yes, of course.
Well, let me ask you, how long is it?
How long is the 100 metres track?
Yeah.
It's a 100 metres track.
Yeah, I know what it is, Mr. Wilson. I'm asking you how long it is.
Now the light is falling, this will be our last goodbye.
Senator Boswell, thanks for your time.
I don't know where they are. I can't see him. Am I supposed to be able to see him?
Senator Boswell, can
Couldn't
you hear me?
Couldn't I be able to see him?
Mr. Ruddock, thanks for your time.
What I will say with regard to that is that the department and indeed officers in the department
Mr. Ruddock, I haven't asked you anything yet. Okay, buzzer's working. Gareth Evans. Cheryl Kerno. Yep, Laurie Oakes. Terrific. Okay, first question. Now, hang on, Gareth.
I think I can find a place in my organisation for an enterprising young man like you, Jack.
What if I say no?
Just remember, the King's fairly handy when it comes to karate.
Actually, the name, Marcus Croft, rings a bit of a bell.
Yeah, what sort of bell?
I think he might have applied for a grant.
Did he get one?
Who put that trike on the table?
My only strength was that I came from the audience, and I had a kind of idea of what the audience might like. So the job for me was how you go from being in the audience and knowing roughly what you'd like to see to doing it without anybody noticing.
Anyway, this kid was sitting in the class this day writing this essay and he felt crook. Well, nobody was terribly surprised, of course, because this kid got crook every day of the week. It was the school milk that did it. This was in the days, of course, when there was such a thing as school milk. This is before the politicians decided that kids didn't like school milk. And if they did like it, they didn't want it. If they both liked it and wanted it, then they bloody well weren't going to get it. And what they used to do was they used to stack the school milk out in the sun for a couple of hours to curdle nicely for the children. Put a little green head on it about so high. Normally after school milk time, there'd be a few fairly pale faces lurking about the place. And now and again, we'd have to have a visit from the sawdust man. You remember him, do you?
I could name all sorts of people who influenced me, including people I knew. Because, of course, the people you know in this world are a much greater influence on you than the people you don't know. But lots of people I have known have got a shareholding in Fred Dagg. Lots of them. And I say that with gratitude.
John Clark screenplay traps an advisor to a government minister in a scandal over a body in a freezer. It's Murray Whelan, Stiff, at 9.50 on Saturday. News is next, tonight here on One. Over on TV2, join Hollywood's A-list for the Academy Awards.